Just a few days ago, I was scrolling through my Pinterest feed as I would usually do, when I came across this beautiful shot right here. If you don't know it already, this is the stunning St. Paul's Cathedral located in London, and as soon as I saw it, I knew I wanted to try my hand at modeling something like that. So I grabbed my main reference, taken from the southern side of the cathedral, a cross-section, a high-res floor plan, and I decided to set up a little challenge for myself. As such, I'll be limited to just these three references to try and push my imagination a bit, while still, of course, trying to catch as much as possible of the vibe of the original shot. Finally, the entire process is subject to a time constraint, which I set in 10 days. With that in mind, and with the caveat that I can still use a few of my own resources, let's see how it went. First thing, I imported my reference into Blender, and if you don't want to reload it every time you open your project file, just click this fake user option, since Blender will discard any unused data block every time it restarts. I began by blocking the main shapes out, working as well on the proportions of the different elements in the composition. And yes, even if you have a limited amount of available time to complete a project, even a rough definition of the main forms is still pretty useful. In fact, it allows you to get comfortable with the shapes you are going to model in detail later on. It is nevertheless the easier way to spot early on anything that doesn't really work well, or that may need a bit more of attention than what you thought. Additionally, it is a way to block the camera right away, which means you will probably save a lot of time as you will know from the beginning what is actually going to be in the final shot. With proportions out of the way, it is now time to put everything into real world scale. And with a height apparently of 111 meters, I went back into Blender, added a cube, enabled the edge length option from the overlays, and started scaling up to the desired dimension. I then joined everything together, placed it right onto the floor, changed the pivot point to the 3D cursor, and scaled again up to match the height of the reference. And with the blockout ready, it was time to begin modeling for real. Our cathedral can be broken down logically into three main sections, and I decided to start the modeling process from the lower floor. And what caught my eyes the most was this nice profile here at the top, so I went straight with that. I imported one of my custom profiles into the scene, and I began rearranging it based on what I could tell from my reference. Once done, I repositioned the mesh using the floor plan as a guide. Now, this section here represents the two columns beneath the profile, which means that this is the width at the bottom and not at the top. So to model it with the right proportions, all I had to do was to flip the view upside down and to continue working from there. To model this kind of sharp turns, we need to take our rightmost edge loop and rotate it by 45 degrees, so that we can then simply extrude up. So, we need to push these vertices to the right and this other to the left. As such, this will be our transformation axis. As we cannot do that with the standard rotation, let me show you instead how to use the shear tool. Once enabled, it is sufficient to left-click and drag on the transformation axis. From the panel, we can type 1 or minus 1, depending on the orientation, to get that perfect 45 degrees angle we were looking for. It is then a matter of extruding, extruding again, resetting the angle when needed, and repeating the same steps for each turn. As you can see in the end, it is pretty easy to model even complex shapes when using the right tools. Next up is the profile for this curved section here. So I borrowed a section from my own mesh, from the curves menu I added a circle and I rescaled it according to the reference. I then moved the 3D cursor at the origin point of the circle and the section of the profile to the 3D cursor. I gave it a couple of edge loops to help with the curvature and then I added a curve modifier targeting the circle, adjusting the rotation of my mesh, as curves can be a bit tricky at times. Once again, we need to look upside down for the right proportions, and with that done, we can select one of the extremities, enable the spin tool this time, and by clicking the plus icon, some magic will happen. We can tweak the number of steps to get uniform topology, and repeat the same process the other way around. For the profile at the top, I reused what I had just done, leveraging on the blockout, which already has the correct proportions. To finalize it this time, I simply eyeball the reference, using again the shear tool. I then extruded both the top and bottom walls down, directly from the respective profiles, while to create the triangular shape at the top, once again I borrowed a section from a mesh, moving the center loop all the way up. To create the inner piece of the pediment, I went instead old school with just some manual loops and adjustments, but you can of course try your hand with booleans and the likes if you want to keep it non-destructive. Let's now talk about columns, because we need a few variations. A rounded fluted one for the entrance and the dome, a rounded plain variation for the side pediments, a square column for the lower floor, and a shorter variation for the upper floor. And lastly, there's another variation with a groove right beneath the central pediment. I imported from my asset browser the rounded fluted type which I had already modeled in the past, and I then displaced 6 placeholder planes around the main circumference. I then made the placeholders the parent of the column, and this will allow me to activate the instancing on faces to get my 6 columns all at once without duplicating the underlying data. After that, it was then simply a matter of adjusting the position and scale of the columns. When creating the other variations, I began duplicating the original blend file within the folder my asset browser is pointing to, as to end up with a distinct file for each column type. In this way, I still have all of them available within the asset browser, but without stuffing everything within a single messed up file. Once placed the other columns with the same instancing technique used for the 6 at the entrance, I turned my attention to the side windows of the bottom floor. And apart from the usual profile and shear work, there is a nice tip for modeling the metal bars, which consists in creating a plane, subdividing it a few times, and then adding a wireframe modifier to it. You can then duplicate the plane and remove the modifier to get the glass as well. With this technique, it is easy to create seemingly complex patterns in a matter of seconds. And this is the way I basically modeled all of the railings throughout the entire scene. For the base of the dome, I used again the curve modifier in combination with the spin tool to get the circular pattern. And again, I added a few placeholder planes to create new instances of my rounded fluted column. Let me now show you a different technique to create circular patterns, which is more suited for composite meshes like this one here. From the curves menu, I'll add a circle and I'll scale it up as needed. I will then select my mesh and give it a curve modifier, and these are exactly the same steps that we use for the spin tool at this point. But now things are going to differ. I'll add an array modifier at the top of the stack, and I'll bring the number of iterations up to the point I'm trying to close the pattern. The problem is that even if you enable the merge option also for the first and last copies of the pattern, these still won't merge at all. And the reason why is that being the array modifier at the top, what it actually sees is this, where the extremities are not even remotely touching. So to amend that, I'll disable the array modifier for now and just apply the curve modifier. I'll then add an empty at the center of the circle, and within the array modifier, I'll switch from relative offset to object offset targeting the empty. I'll now rotate the empty to get the first two pieces of the array in place, and then bring again the number of iterations up until the pattern is finally closed. For the dome itself, I simply used a UV sphere divided in half, using the blockout as a benchmark to assess the right dimensions. To create the ribs, I duplicated the sphere and I proceeded to select every edge loop coming down from the pole. I then beveled the selection, extruded it along the normals and deleted the rest. With the same technique, I modeled the remaining details. So, at the end of this modeling streak, this is what I had. It was then time to move on to the next stage. So, my idea here was actually pretty simple. I knew I wanted a base PBR stone marble material to start with, and then a few grunge textures for dirt, leaks and stains to add a bit of variation. Hence, I created a new material, imported my base textures, and added a color ramp right away to reduce the overall glossiness. I then brought the first grunge map in, added a mixed color node to combine the original albedo with the color variation sampled from the reference, where the grunge map will work as the factor between the two. I then duplicated the texture map and imported a new grunge map to repeat the process, just with a different color variation. Like that, I proceeded to use all the different maps I had prepared in advance to try and replicate the wary look of the material in the shot. Since some of these maps actually represent dirt, they should affect also the overall roughness of the material. As such, I started mixing them together by using again a mixed color node with the blending mode set on screen to make the dirt applied on the mesh look less reflective. Remember, by the way, to change the color mode of the grunge maps to non-color to avoid having to readjust your textures later on. A cool trick is to use the random per island output socket of the geometry node to overlay on top of the albedo an additional layer of variation, as you would expect to see in a real building made of different chunks of stone. Lastly, I connected the output of one of the dirt maps to the height value of a bump node to add variation also to the normal map. To mix it with the normal map of the base material, it is enough to add a mixed vector node and connect both normal maps to it. With this simple material in place, I created a few variations in my asset browser and I started texturing all the different assets in the scene. For the columns in particular, I wanted to have a cleaner version of the material for those located at the second floor and a darker tone as well to be applied to the column capitals. At this stage, I would usually apply the mirror modifiers to avoid obvious repetition in the textures, and I would proceed as well to UV unwrap again some of my meshes when needed. For the brick pattern, I jumped into Substance Designer where I assembled a very quick material. I then loaded the normal map into Blender and mixed it with the rest using another mix vector node. Since I didn't want to mess with the rotation of my wall's UVs, I triplanar mapped the texture by changing the texture coordinate from UVs to object and the texture from flat to box. Then I brought the ambient occlusion in as well and multiplied it over the albedo to enhance a bit the visibility of the brick pattern, since the final shot will be taken from a certain distance. Lastly, I imported the random color mask created in Designer to add color variation on a brick by brick basis. At this point, I decided to add a bit of a hand-painted touch to the material. I duplicated the principal shader and connected it to the maps of the base material. I then added a mix shader node to combine my two shaders. For the factor, I created a new black texture, gave it a name and a resolution, and I connected it to the factor socket. It was time now to grab the pen and the tablet and to switch to texture painting mode. I loaded one of the grunge maps as the texture of the brush, and back into the brush settings I changed the mapping from tile to stencil. So I began painting here and there, trying to break the uniformity of the patterns. Now, if you want to improve the quality of your work and add a bit of your personality into your scenes, even if you are not that much into digital sculpting, you may still want to consider owning a tablet. And the reason why is pretty simple. Whether it is texture or vertex painting, or sculpting of course, your mouse is only going to be on or off, either clicked or not, while with a pen you can have thousands of different levels of sensitivity depending on your hands alone. For this project, the folks at HUION nicely let me put my hands on the KAMVAS Pro 13 2.5K, which, apart from display pen and cables, comes bundled with a few additional treats such as extra nibs, a cleaning cloth, an artist glove, and more importantly, a stand. The display is 13.3 inches in size, which, considered also its weight and thickness, means it is portable, and still holds a resolution of 2560 by 1600 that returns crisp and clear images. Additionally, such resolution can easily handle softwares with pretty busy UIs. The interaction with the display is completely customizable, so there is no need for you to take your hands off of it while working. The pen, which is battery-free, has more than 8000 pressure levels and can be adapted to whatever your drawing style is. So, if you're thinking about introducing a tablet into your toolkit, do take a look at this, as it is great value for money. I'll leave a link down below in the description. Back to St.Paul, at this point I was basically running out of time. I quickly started adding the missing details as well as all the other different items within the scene, such as the main road, some props, treated vegetation and also a cube with a principal volume shader for the atmosphere. The statues I used come from a nice pack by Dada Design, while trees and vegetation are from the Botanica Dome. And with that, it was time to move to the next and final chapter. The reference shot was taken during a pretty moody and cloudy day, with no evident direct light sources apart from what was coming from the sky itself. My setup was then very basic, with simply an HDRI lighting the entire scene to try and recreate the flat, overcast feeling. Before rendering, I enabled the ambient occlusion pass in the layer panel, since I will use it later when compositing, while for the format I chose a 3:4 ratio like the one in the shot. Without touching any other setting, I went on and finally hit the F12 button. In the compositing workspace, I added a couple of extra views for both my render result and the main reference, just to have them side by side during the process. As the first thing, I wanted to add the cloudy sky dominating the scene. So I added an image node, loaded an HDRI and connected it to the render result through the alpha over node, switching between different image sources to find the right one. The next step was to multiply the ambient occlusion pass on top of the render to add a bit of dimension to it. But now everything was just too dark, so I added back a bit of exposure as well. With the RGB curves node, I tried to increase a bit the contrast by darkening the shadows, while with the color balance node, I basically wanted to give a bit of an extra push to the highlights. Finally, I added a bit of additional contrast again at the end of the compositing chain, and I went back to slightly increase the exposure. And that was it. This is the main reference. Well, this is what I ended up with. And consider that I stayed within the 10 days limit for a total of 18 hours of work. While it surely has issues, it's still a solid attempt. So, I hope you enjoyed the video, and see you next time.